we're part of a research team from NIWA, working with scientists from the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution and GNS Science up here on the Kermadec Ridge. This is an area northeast of New Zealand. The really important thing and interesting thing about it is that it's formed of a line of underwater volcanoes. The animal life we're researching is several kilometres deep, so we can't go down there with normal means. We can't scuba dive, for example, down to those sorts of depths. So we use two different types of sampling technique. The first uses a camera in a towed frame, which we keep 3 or 4 metres off the seafloor and tow along the flanks and into the craters of these volcanoes. The camera frame has both video and still photographic capability. There's no light at the depths we're operating, so therefore the cameras have to take their own lights under the water as well. You'll see in the middle of some of these frames two red dots, which are laser dots, 20 centimetres apart, which gives us the ability to tell how large the animals are. The life down there is quite variable. We have, in some of these shots, corals, sponges, crinoids, or sea lilies as they're often called. These are found widely around New Zealand. They're not associated with the hydrothermal vents. They live in the normal cold water down there. However, here we can now see some hydrothermal vent fauna. These are stalked barnacles, which are very common on some volcanoes on the Kermadec Arc. They're like normal barnacles, which you might see on the coast, on the rocky shores around New Zealand, but they're on quite a long stalk, which raises them up above the seafloor, so they get away from the sediment, which moves around with the ocean currents. You can also see swarms of shrimps. These are associated with the slightly warmer waters which we get around the vents, where there's diffuse venting, so the temperature may be 5 to 10 degrees warmer than normal seawater at those depths. They're completely blind. They don't need eyes to see down there, so they're using their other senses, in particular smell and feel, to find their food and to scrape bacteria off the rocks. As well as the invertebrates, that is animals without backbones, we get a lot of fish in the area. And here we have a nice example of a skate just resting on the seafloor. Here we see a deep sea eel called a basketwork eel because of the pattern on its scales. It scavenges on the seafloor. The camera gives us fantastic photos, but often to identify exactly what the animals are, we have to physically catch them so we can examine them in detail. To do that, we use a sled. It's called an epibenthic sled. It gets lowered down to the sea floor and towed slowly along for several hundred metres and then hauled up, containing a combination of rocks and seafloor life that is living on them. The sled comes back onto the after deck of Tangaroa, where it's emptied, and then the biological team come in and sort out the animals. So the animals will come to those of us from NIWA, and the rocks go to the GNS scientists, who are concerned with the composition and the structure of the habitat on which the animals are living. The catch gets separated into species, or these things that look the same, get catalogued and weighed, and the good specimens, the specimens that are in fresh condition, then get taken away for photographing.
Well, here we have a coral community with a cup corals, stony corals, which forms a matrix which gives an area for other animals to live, like this large carnivorous worm.
When I first see a sample that I think I want to photograph, it's usually got to be in really good condition. The first thing is I'll clean it up a little bit so it looks nice, and then I'll zoom in on areas that are of taxonomic interest, which are keys to identifying that individual. The environment at that depth is dark, permanent darkness. Animals that don't have eyes are just restricted to their feeding appendages, which they will extend out into the current or rummage through all the mud and detritus on the seafloor. And in some cases, like these brittle stars, they'll climb up on top of a coral and extend their arms out into the water mass to just give themselves a greater surface area to obtain this food. They survive perfectly well in unison. The thing that enchants me about seeing these animals that come up from the deep sea is that they are very similar to the ones we see in many regards in shallow waters, just in your tidal rock pool at your local beach. But how do they live in those deep oceans? And they do survive very well. And the range and form, the intricacies of their patterns, their coloration, is just remarkable. And for me, it's a bit like a painting, really. They're just beautiful. And diversity is just incredible.